Здравствуйте. Мы очень долго ждали Ефима Ивановна, но, к сожалению, транспортная ситуация в Москве не идеальна до сих пор. Поэтому я передаю всем пламенный привет прямо из пробки, говорит, что скоро будет. В общем, вместо него, профессора Бычка, представлю вам я. Во-первых, хочется поблагодарить каждого из вас за то, что вы пришли сюда, и за то, что благодаря вам, собственно, весь этот проект стал возможным. Соответственно, не знаю, никакого смысла рассказывать о том. Про экспертный совет, простите, я вот не спикер, очень волнуюсь. Да, просто спасибо огромное за то, что вы нашли в себе желание, нашли ресурсы и нашли возможность поддержать проект экспертной оценки, проект Ленинской магистральной магистрали. Пару слов о профессоре, хотя, наверное, это человек в такой категории, который не нуждается в представлении, но все же. Профессор Буканучик – заслуженный профессор Пенсильванского университета. Он получил образование по специальности проектирования транспорта и дорожных потоков в Белградском и Калифорнийском университетах. С 1967 года он работает в Пенсильванском университете, а также является приглашенным профессором в Белградском, Лиссабонском университете, университете Сан-Паулу, а также в университетах Сингапура и ЮАР. Профессор Буканучик консультировал Министерство транспорта США, администрацию Филадельфии, департамент транспорта Нью-Йорка, Сан-Франциско и Вашингтона, а также принимал участие в различных транспортных проектах в Белграде, Каракасе, Эдмонтоне, Лиме, Манчестере, Мехико, Неаполе, Нью-Йорке, Перте, Фениксе, Лиме и Торонто. Он является членом Академии наук, научных и профессиональных сообществ Сербии, России и США. Отчетный профессор Римского университета, университета Салерно, Парижского университета, университета города Дели, Кореи. Он опубликовал множество книг старших классиков урбанистики. Я думаю, многие из вас их читали, в том числе книга, которая уже переведена на русский язык «Транспорт в городах, удобно для жизни», а также книга «Эксплуатация и планирование экономика общественного транспорта» и книга «Система и технологии общественного транспорта». Ну, собственно, профессор Буканучик – регулярный лектор университета Германии, Швейцарии, Японии, Италии, Бразилии, Португалии, ЮАР, Китая, Кореи и США. Ну и наконец-то я замолчу и с радостью передам вам микрофон. Спасибо, что пришли. Профессор Буканучик.
Спасибо. Спасибо большое. Добрый вечер. We are talking again about transportation in Moscow. And I'm again glad to have a group of people who are very interested in the topic. Transportation becomes very popular as problems increase, but transportation really represents a set of arteries, like blood stream in the body of the city. And if it doesn't work well, the whole city suffers. In deciding what should be the topic today, I decided in agreement with Mr. Katz and others that it would be interesting to review what are the problems today we're facing, what are the decisions are being made, which considerations are made, and so on. And really relate that to what happened in other countries when they were at this stage of transportation development. Some of the people in Moscow and in Russia say this has never happened, we are unique, and so on. You're not unique, there are many similarities that happened in other countries with the developments, which I'll review in a minute. But that means that we should look into what happened 50 and 80 years ago or 40 years ago in other countries and which measures were proper, good, logical, which ones were inconsistent, colliding some policies with other policies, and which ones were direct mistakes, which are very costly and have done great damages to many cities. So we want to compare that, and I have selected particularly the items that come up in discussions, arguments that people bring. Some are very sophisticated arguments, and all cities are facing some of these problems, how to design transportation related to the city, how to make the city livable, and so on. On the other hand, you have many reactions, even among professionals and certainly in the public, which are reactions that were found in other cities, and some of them are quite rudimentary. And some of the rudimentary problems of not understanding issues in urban transportation are very important to resolve and to avoid the mistakes that were made before. So some of you were probably here yesterday. I talked more specifically about different modes of transportation, about buses and metro and tramway and trolleybus and so on. Today I'm going to talk more about organizational things. And just to give you a brief introduction, what happened in cities around the world up to about 1890? The cities were designed for walking, horse riding, or horse-drawn vehicles. So they were really walking cities. And they were designed more for the scale of walking, very close, dense, and so on. The cities in the 19th century grew rapidly because there was industrialization and urbanization, that means movement from villages into the cities. There was a greater and greater need for better transportation in cities. And there were two aspects where the transportation became a bottleneck, a problem in development of the cities. What were the two problems? One was, how do you supply the city with needs, everything to daily food? There were even studies, theoretically, if you could have all the gardens and cattle and so on grown around the city, what is the size of the city that you could support? And that became a problem as cities became with 2 or 3 million people. There were no refrigerators, there were no fast transportation modes, and so on. So that was one problem. The second problem was, how do people travel within cities? And if you are walking to work, which the vast majority of people were doing, then you cannot live 8 kilometers from your house. It's just not physically possible and convenient. So that led to tremendous construction of high-density residential areas in center city. This is when those slums were developed in New York, in London. If you read Charles Dickens' story of terrible life in those areas and so on. So cities try to provide better transportation. Various motorized vehicles were tried, but the motors did not work until electric motor was made to operate vehicles. And I should say, before that, in 1825 was the big invention. What was that? Железная дорога. So that was the railway, which solved the problems of supplies. We could get huge quantities of food, so that was not a limit on cities' growth anymore from 1820s, 30s, 40s. And railways rapidly covered the countries. But then, to some extent, even increased the concentration in center city. Railways served several stations, but did not provide distribution. So internal passenger transport, the revolution was, which Siemens invented the electric motor, made an electric tramway, with Sprague in the United States and some geniuses of electric traction. Within 10 years, we had electric tramways and metros began to be built. So around 1900, we inherited cities that were pedestrian oriented. from 1900, rapidly, cities got tramways everywhere in industrialized countries. And for several decades, transit really allowed the development of the city and allowed people to live some distance and commute to traffic to work. And thereby, the living standards increased rapidly and densities decreased and the mobility increased. That was a significant contribution of public transportation. And then the next invention after these transit cities was the automobile that first was used by few people, but then came massive ownership of automobiles. First in the United States, but then in Western Europe and Japan and so on. And with you rather recently, that caused another explosion in transportation because public transport, pedestrian transport, gives you good, fast travel along a network, mostly radial and mostly in the cities. Automobile gives you ability to travel at any time to any place. So people began to use the automobile very extensively, and that created a lot of possibilities and also the problems that when we had the use of automobiles in large cities, congestion appeared and the whole transportation became less reliable and became also a problem in the cities. So the cities which tried then to respond immediately. If you have a congested street, what should we do? Well, we should widen the street, right? And since vehicles, automobiles need, they are certainly more important than these pedestrians. So we began to narrow down the pedestrian ways and neglect pedestrians and build more traffic lanes. Then in, for example, Los Angeles, many highways were built. There was not enough parking. So you start building parking. And then you create some huge parking garages where streets are not sufficient for cars to come to those garages. So it was going between providing more highways and then more parking and more highways and more parking. That was the automobile-based city. And some cities really believe that future is the automobile. Transit will be just for those who really cannot drive. They are too old or children and those who just are not so successful. So we give them less attention. Successful people have automobiles. We did not see the big picture. And we had plans in the United States for the set national network of what we call freeways. That means roads without any intersections. We have somewhat confused terms in America, what is freeway, expressway, and highway is just any road and so on. But we mean under freeways, officially the definition is the same as it is Autobahn in Germany, motorway in England, Autostrada in Italy, Autoroute in France. That's a concept that you don't have exactly yet defined, and you should have some more definitions in planning your highway system. I've talked many times, I don't want to elaborate, the fact that these attempts to really rebuild cities into automobile-based, automobile-oriented, and so on, created enormous problems. They created continuous congestion, more congestion than in cities which developed different modes of transportation. They developed huge segregation in mobility. People who have cars could travel nicely, unless it's Propka. And those who don't have cars are second-class citizens. They sometimes cannot find the job or cannot get to the job. So anyway, The Oro-based city was developed intensively in the United States in many cities during the 1950s and 60s. Europeans sometimes sent committees to America to see what is going on and what should be done. What is America doing? At the same time, Great Britain, Germany, France undertook studies which asked this: we widen the street and there are more cars, and we need more parking. We provide more parking. It seems to be an endless thing. So where are we going? How can we now move houses of parliament in London, or what? What do we do with cities? So there were studies made about that collision of cities and cars, as we call it, collision of cities and cars. A famous study was by Buchanan in Britain, who nicely defined that in small cities it's not such a problem because the congestion is not too great. If the ownership of cars is very high, most people can have. And those who don't, for children and so on, we need some transit for more social reasons, but not for capacity. In medium-sized cities, we begin to have problems. In large cities, he showed that there would be tremendous congestion and that it would not be good cities, cannot exist at large scale where most travel is by car. He correctly said that, but he did not understand transportation modes. He was an architect, more oriented toward visual aspects of cities. So he said, if we have that congested situation, we should increase the number of buses. And that is a very naive proposal, which is not a solution, because if you provide buses in a congested street, people will not leave their cars to take something even slower, like your Tverskaya. When it's congested, your buses and trolley buses are fairly empty. So Buchanan did not understand the need that public transport, to be successful, has to be separated, to be independent of congestion. And therefore, you need usually rail transit, you need higher capacity, but you need also what I define as right-of-way, B and A, separated ways, rather than being congestion. The German study on the same topic was much clearer and much more systematic. They defined what kind of transportation is needed in cities, and they defined that we should be improving, to some extent, traffic of automobiles, but we should improve at least as much or give preferential treatment to public transport, and we should make cities more livable. A German study led to even plan for financing that through gasoline, benzene taxes. So that since 1967, Germany has worked very systematically on developing both public transport and private transport. Several other countries have followed that kind of balanced approach. I'm giving you this just to mention that through these decades, we went through various experiences, and we had many mistakes toward auto-based city, lack of coordination and so on. And one of the lessons we have learned is that transportation has a big impact not only how people travel, but what kind of city we have. As the level, the quality of service and quality of life in cities is very much affected by transportation. With respect to technology and modes, we went from the pedestrian city to transit city to the automobile city, and what's the next phase? It's intermodal city. So we are saying we have a great role for private car. We need good, attractive public transport. We should not forget pedestrians. And that's what we have been doing in recent years, discovering that pedestrians should be not only safe and able to survive the crossing of streets, but he or she should feel that the city is pleasant and that you enjoy to be in the city rather than try to escape from the city. What is then the complex problem? Intermodal and systems approach. Systems approach says that we have to look at transportation as one system related to the city and related to the goal of what cities we want to have. And we have to unify, to integrate various functions. For example, parking is often mentioned. Is that just convenience? No, parking is a big element in urban transportation. Parking, various terminals, methods of introducing measures, traffic control, and all of these elements. So that now when we look at the cities which are leading in how they have solved their transportation and created really more livable cities, we see that they have one characteristic, the basic one, that they have the best understanding of this complexity and of the need to integrate agency, which is planning agency for city planning and transportation, and streets department for traffic and parking controls and pedestrian and community and so on. So that complexity is needed, and then those cities have an agency which coordinates all these modes. So today I will start these details from parking, which is just one element, but really it was the first one. I mean, 10 years ago when I came the first time and I saw that you are getting tremendous problems, the first thing that was really obvious was that there was absolute chaos on the street with parking. Just parking was everywhere. You could not walk the streets, you could not cross the streets. And then you have the citizens begin, the loud ones who have power and have cars, they're asking for parking. And at once, the main demand is to provide more parking, not related to where, how to organize that and how to control it and so on. So that the I should tell you, I've translated most of these in Russian, so into Russian. So I will combine somewhat. Speak most English, but there will be some complexity in changing. But I did want to present the text that you can follow here directly. So what we have there is that we still have some people who say парковка общая доступная улица всегда должна быть бесплатной. That is public street, so it should be free. How can you charge for something that is public? I don't want to spend much time on that, but it's really a very naive thing. There are many public things that we still charge for. Even our zoo, we have to pay for it if we use it. The parks are usually public, but any other facilities and museums are also open to the public, but you must contribute. And here, that's philosophically, it's easy to prove that is not correct, that it's public, so you cannot charge. And physically, if you would not pay for it, you would have total chaos. So that's a completely naive statement, and it should be immediately rebutted and refused. Нужно разрешить парковку на тротуарах. years ago, when I walked Tverskaya Street, I had to go to the main street into traffic to avoid one person who parked there and blocked. So then one person was blocking 100 of us. So obviously, that is not correct. If you have very wide trottoir, then you can organize parking, yes. But uncontrolled parking on the streets is also something that is not acceptable. Have the other cities had the same problem? Yes. Rome comes to mind always. Rome was so chaotic that you could not walk even in residential streets. Somebody is blocking completely. One person blocks, you have to go all the way around the street. And somehow, it took several decades for some cities to get to that. I'm just telling you, you can speed up if you take the experiences of others. So this unlimited parking on trottoirs should be also eliminated everywhere. The claim is that parking outside of street, in garages and so on, it should be a part of the private business. Well, and then, of course, there was a document published by Moscow about 3-4 years ago, which said how many metro lines will be built, which is fine, how many vehicles will be purchased, and so on. One of the items was we need three or four million parking spaces in center city. Well, that statement I've criticized with many of your leaders, and they are now aware that you don't do like that. Because if you build a million parking spaces in Kremlin, are you reducing property, or are you calling for it, creating for it, okay? So, on the other hand, the off-street parking and so on, it can be privately done. However, parking is one of the strong elements which regulates the traffic situation and the entire problem in city. So that there is a strong argument that parking, two aspects of parking. One is how many parking spaces you provide, and the other one is what kind of payments you're requiring, that greatly influence the condition, flow of traffic in the city, and choice of people to use a car or to use transit. In many cities in the United States, parking is used to attract people. So free parking is ultimate always. They are saying we are selling these things, but it's free parking, and that free parking is always used. And it is extremely counterproductive, and we now have many studies which have shown what the cities which provided a lot of parking, and especially free parking means paid by somebody else, and many cities have more parking garages in center city than all other buildings. That is not a livable city. If you look at that problem, there is a book, High Cost of Free Parking, showing how many cities in the United States have been really damaged and made very pedestrian unfriendly because of that. So that parking should be included in transportation policies and measures in the city. I must admit that there are not many cities which do have regulation of parking garages, which really make a good study how much parking we want in center city and how it would be charged. In many cases, it is cheaper to come and park the whole day than to park for 1 or 2 hours. By hour, it becomes cheaper and cheaper. What's wrong with that? It's wrong that persons who come and park for 8 hours take one space, which otherwise could be used by many people who, for good reasons, need cars for convenient parking and going for other business. So this discount calling commuters to come is unjust, it's heavily subsidized, and it creates very sharp peaks in property in the peak hours. Then the parking meters or payment for parking. Again, some say that that should not be done and so on. And actually, that's also part of the picture. Of course, do you want to pay for parking or not? Everybody will say, I don't want to pay. Whoever asks us something, would you like to pay or not to pay? Of course, we'll say not. But the consequences are somewhat different. In many cities, people oppose, I have to pay that meter all the time and so on. When parking meters were introduced, there was a much higher turnover. So the purpose of parking meters is not only to collect revenue, to have money for better transportation or city and so on. They're also to prevent people from coming and parking for six or 10 hours on city streets, which is not possible or not desirable. So that when meters were introduced, at once some drivers, users of automobiles, said, this is great, now I can come and I'll pay so much per hour, but I can come for an hour and then go to another business and do again for an hour or so. Before that, I couldn't park anywhere or I would pay some enormous amounts of money and so on. So parking meters are not only for revenue, they are for regulation of length of parking. How you collect parking, they used to be parking meters usually. Now the parking meters have rapidly been changed into the payment kiosks where you pay and then you have a small piece of paper which you pay, put in your car and you show how much you pay. Much simpler, no meters on the street and so on, easier to handle. So methods of charging have been changed and new ones have been used recently. So we should be then include transportation, parking into transportation picture of the city, and especially we should be careful how much parking and what kind of pricing we should do, especially on off-street parking, on neurichnyu, capacity of neurichnyu parking. Should we think about so-called road pricing, that we charge some payment for roads? For many years we have had so-called tolls, right, that you pay and then you drive on the road. That is an interesting history. Germany, which is very much ahead in logical and coordinated policy, is way behind on tolls. They have all these autobahns all without any charges. While some other countries, in the United States also, are developing more and more paved roads. That they are public roads, that really is not relevant, as I argued already. But we were thinking then, should we charge in cities where there is density and greater problem than outside? But we had two problems. How can you on the street make one place where you have toll, you spend, stop and pay, and then in another street you have to pay again, and that payment is different streets and different times of day and so on. So physically, how would you do that? And second problem was political, that people would not like that. You would have to convince people for that. With electronics and with chip cards and so on, and contactless and scanners above and so on, the first problem has disappeared. We can now charge anything we want at any place without stopping cars. Has that been done somewhere? Anybody knows who is using road user charges?
Yes.
London.
Before London, 20 years ago.
Stockholm.
What? No, Stockholm a year or two. Who was 20 years ahead of London? Which is in many things not difficult, but in this one, Singapore. Singapore has coordinated policy, has a policy that really relates auto and transit and livability and so on. Singapore introduced especially the charges in a very simple way first, but now they're developing more and more all these scanning controls. So they used to call it a cordon count around the city. Now they call it ERP, electronic road pricing. And why that is very interesting is that they are measuring traffic speeds every 3 months. If the traffic is very slow, they say this is approaching breakdown and congestion. We don't want congestion. Let's raise the payments. And they raise the payments and the traffic begins to flow faster because some 5 or 8% of people don't want to use it. So it's better for road users, and we shift the others on transit, which is also what we want. Then they measure 3 months later and traffic is very fast. And they said, well, we really could allow some more people. So they lowered some of that. So they are really using this ERP, electronic road pricing, not to maximize the revenue, but to really reduce and avoid property, which means to make the whole traffic much more efficient and much more with much less negative impact. You know, property is not only inconvenience for us sitting there, but it's the air, it's the pollution, it's the inability to have an appointment. You cannot come when you agree. The whole economic life in the city is affected very seriously. So Singapore is doing that extensively. London, after a big fight, has introduced, and several other cities, Scandinavian cities, have used. I think that gradually we will get there to understand that that is a rational thing, and that even those who are driving will eventually see that it's better to pay and then be able to drive without big problems and park much more rationally and so on. In London, the city is functioning better. There's somewhat fewer cars. The congestion is much smaller. There is more people on public transport. There are more people walking around the city, if only. So that is the, and why I'm saying that here, I think you are probably fairly far from that. You would have revolution if you suggested that to come in 3 months. But you should start discussing now, because it takes some years to discuss and to see various aspects and to educate the public and to plan very carefully. If you don't even talk about it, you will postpone that decision. But I think that in many cities, many large cities, we will be using more road pricing. The How do you finance transportation? Well, that's a long, complicated subject, but we have two types of financing. Well, organizationally, we usually have the local level, the city level, and then is the state level or country level, two or three levels. We have general taxation, which means from general fund of the country or the city, or we have so-called user taxation. And that means that people who are using facilities are paying. Those are the tolls or road user charges. Road user charges are easier to get than general taxes, because when you tell people we'll charge this, but for that amount we will build this and this project, people are more likely to accept that. In Norway, Norway is fantastic how much it has built in transportation and what an excellent public transport system they have, the national railway and buses and boats all along the coast. And in the city of Oslo, which is only about 500,000 and with surroundings 1.5 million, they have excellent tramway, light rail, and metro and regional rail. They're amazing. They wanted to put some tolls. They needed some money, and they said, we will put the tolls here around Oslo, and we will improve that road around, like you are called, so, and we will build this and this rail line that we need. And that was approved, and it is successful. So that's one of the ways of funding. And in some cases, some countries use the so-called user charges and for different modes and so on. Now, you also do have argument, бензин, должен быть дешевле, потому что Россия производит и экспортирует его. You probably heard this. We have so much oil, and we are paying more taxes here. We should really have cheap oil. That argument is not very valid from the economic and social point of view. It is not how cheap is your oil from the ground. It is what's the opportunity cost. Instead of selling to the world and getting that revenue, you would be giving cheaper gasoline. You really, the cost to you would be high, because by not selling at the world price, you would be selling at a lower price. So you would be subsidizing that, and it's economically not a valid argument that because you are producing it, it should be cheaper. In Saudi Arabia, maybe, but that's a different situation. Now the fact that the road pricing would benefit the center city is one important factor. The other one is that, again, like parking meters, the drivers of automobiles, many drivers would prefer the situation in the traffic if you have road pricing and you have more reliable service than if you have very low cost system and very bad traffic conditions. This is basic fact that is not always understood. We do have a major problem between different modes, particularly street traffic, automobile travel, and public transport. We always, well, it's often said, oh, that public transport is subsidized tremendously. Our public money goes to public transport. While car drivers are paying for what their costs are, for the fencing and for the parking or whatever it is. The picture is not as simple as that. And the problem is that the costs of travel, if we travel by automobile, the cost of benzene per kilometer is very low. You never avoid traveling another 10 kilometers because you will spend much benzene, right? Even if it's expensive, cost per kilometer is very, very low. The cost is if you have parking or road pricing or something like that. So that if you have given parking, say, by the institution, if you don't pay for parking, this is what you are facing to pay for a, say, 8 kilometer trip into the city and out of the city. If you pay for parking, then that is much more, and this would be the toll also, road pricing or something like that. Now, many people say, oh, I travel by car because it costs me so much for benzene and parking so much, and that's it. Those two out-of-pocket costs, we call them out-of-pocket, that means if I travel, I pay today or these days directly. That is only a small part of your total cost of your automobile, because you paid many thousands of rubles for the automobile, right? And you paid for auto insurance, and you paid for maintenance, and all of these costs. So that the your own cost is also high here. But you use only this to decide how much it costs you, and then you compare that with how much you pay for the bus or for the metro. And sometimes